Hello, thanks guys for joining me for this session. So this session is on Apache MXNet. So Apache MXNet, first of all, is not an Amazon framework. It's an open source framework. It's an Apache project. And I want to discuss the merits of this project and why you should take interest into this project. So first of all, there are just too many deep learning projects, right? Why come up with one more? So the reasons for that are, you know, by each passing day, we are training larger and larger models. And as you know, memory is the most costly resource. Compute is cheap these days, but memory is still very expensive. And many trainings are now out of bound for single machine, a single machine even with multiple GPUs. So you need to go for distributed training, and you need something that scales seamlessly. So all these problems are being solved on the server side. There has been little more success on the client side. I just want to mention these things for your convenience. So again, as I said, memory is a very expensive resource. So a lot of techniques have been developed to conserve memory on the client side. Now models are being executed on your mobile phones. So there is this very interesting researcher from Stanford, Song Han. He has done some very interesting work in making models compact. So one of some of the techniques are, you know, reducing the number of weak connections, using less resolution for the weights, right? Or rather less precision for the weight. And all these things have been possible without losing much of accuracy. So I would say there is relatively more success on the client side, but memory issues remain very significant on the server side. By server side, I mean for the training. So let us first see who are the backers for this project. So you will see a lot of prominent names here, including Amazon. These are the companies and universities who are behind this project. This is a list of top MXNet collaborators. Since this is an open source project, we want to honor their contributions. And I want to show that this is a pretty healthy framework in terms of activity, in terms of new features, bug fixes, requests. So as you see, MXNet is not at the level of TensorFlow, which is much more popular, but it is coming up rapidly. It is consistently at number 3. So it's a promising project for sure. So let us just revise a very basic fundamental. This is a very simplified depiction of how a neural network works. I use this image just to signify that there are lots of matrix calculations, and the number of matrix calculations are extremely high for multi-layer networks, and a lot of the values are required to be preserved to calculate the value of next layer, right? The output of one layer is input to the next layer, and typically we do batching to speed up training, and batching means, you know, that much many more values to be stored. So memory requirements simply explode. So how MXNet handles these challenges? So MXNet provides all these cool features. You can read them yourself, but I want to focus today on two main, the ones which are painted red. First is it supports declarative and imperative programming. I'll discuss what it means. And it does transparent scaling. I'll also discuss, you know, what it means. So let us quickly take a look at the building blocks of MXNet. So I can't go through all of them, but they are there for your review. So dependency engine is one of the most important thing that MXNet has. And this engine supports parallelism. It automatically figures out where the operations can be carried out parallelly, because writing parallel programs by yourself is very difficult. It figures out all the opportunities for parallelizing by itself. So this is an example of how parallelism is managed. I'm going to share these slides so you can go through all the layers. It's pretty self-explanatory if you just look at the name of the layers. So this is a very simple example of what I mean by auto-parallelization. So there is a small program on left. So you are computing A, C, B, and D. D is the final outcome. So it automatically figures out that C and B can be computed parallelly, and they can be added up to arrive at D. So it's pretty neat. Like, it doesn't allow you to make mistakes of not making things parallel. Next thing is it supports two types of API. One is symbolic and second is imperative. So what it means, let us take a quick look at these examples. In fact, I would go to the next slide. So I want you to focus on left side first. It's a very simple program. Some variables are being added. And as the comment says, C cannot share memory with D because it could be used in future. The system that is going to execute this program has no knowledge whether C is going to be required in future or not. So it keeps memory allocated to C. Memory gets wasted, right? On the right-hand side, the same thing has been written in a symbolic way or a declarative way. So here what we do is we first define a graph. The graph is F. It has all the same operations as on this side, but it doesn't allocate any memory. And when the execution happens, when the inputs A and B are supplied to the graph F, it automatically figures out what is the most efficient way of allocating memory. So for example, C can share memory with D. For example, once C is computed, and now we want to go to compute D, you can store D in the place where C was stored because you know now that it is not required anymore. So it makes memory utilization very efficient. There are some quick stats. As I said, it supports both symbolic and imperative programming. 90% of your runtime will consist of symbolic graphs. They're very easy to write, right? Basically, you define a model, you add layers, activation functions, and things like that. It requires less than 10% of the time. But there are going to be many times when you need to do something which is very specific to your training program. For example, you need to process inputs in a certain way. So for that, you can use imperative programming. And that is where you generally end up spending most of the time. So while it consists of 10% of the runtime, you typically end up spending 90% of the time there. Because adding layers to the network and launching the training is very easy. It is the pre-processing and things like that which require more effort. And Okay. So there is one thing that MXNet does. It uses something called as static graphs. So MXNet, TensorFlow, all these guys, you know, they are basically graph computation engines. And they are static graph computation engine. There is a talk following my talk about PyTorch, which supports dynamic graphs. It has some cool features. So my next speaker will be discussing those. But there is one distinctive advantage of static graphs. And I'm going to show it in form of a diagram. So if you see, this is a forward pass and backward pass, you know, diagrammatically represented on left-hand side. And the same diagram is now painted with color. So basically, same color means that those two operations can share memory because the output of the previous operation is no longer needed, right? So for example, when this is being calculated, this guy can use the same memory which was allocated for this operation because output of this operation is no more needed by the time this is being calculated. So memory is optimized extremely aggressively. Next thing that MXNet does is it trades. So here you are not trading anything. You are just saving memory from being wasted. MXNet does one more thing which is very special. What it does is it trades speed for memory. What it means is, as I said, compute cycles are cheaper and most compute cycles are wasted because the data is being transferred from one place to the other and no computation can happen. So generally there are a lot of compute cycles available. So what it does is it expends more compute cycles and it does certain things which require lesser memory for the training process. So there is a lot of pros on the screen, but I'm going to show one diagram which will make this clear. So what MXNet does is it discards the result of small operations in the forward pass and it recomputes them in the backward pass. So forward pass is happening and you reach the end stage and there is where you calculate your loss and now you are ready to calculate your gradient. But by the time that stage arrives, a lot of outputs of the intermediate layers are deleted to recover memory, okay? And it is deleted because recomputing them is not very hard. As I said, compute is cheap. If you delete output of an operation, recomputing it is easy. Okay, so you go fast up to the stage where you calculate loss and start calculating the gradient. And in that process, you have lost a lot of layer outputs. You recompute them. So there is a simple formula. You keep result of square root of n out of n layers. For example, if you have got 16 layers, you will preserve output of only 4 layers. Okay, and you can recompute the lost layers during the backward pass. And this allows you to train square root n times larger model at 75% of the speed. So in this case, where you have got 16 layers, you can train square root of 16. That is 4 times a larger model. So this is being represented diagrammatically. I'll spend a little more time on this diagram to explain what I mean. So this is how the normal process works. A forward pass happens. The forward pass happens, and then the backward pass begins. And the backward pass requires the activation outputs of the intermediate stages, right? And since these all outputs are needed, you need to preserve them in RAM, and that requires you to expend a lot of RAM, or memory rather. Okay, so in this approach, this is a modified approach which MXNet follows. What it does is, for example, it deletes the output of batch normalization layer and ReLU layer, and it goes very fast up to the stage where it is ready to calculate loss. And once the backward pass starts, right, backward pass is progressing. So at this stage, it requires this value. At this stage, it requires this value. So these values are computed just in time one more time. So they are deleted because it is not very difficult to recompute them. But they are required again. And at that time, they are recomputed very easily. So that's how a lot of unnecessary memory wastage is saved, which allows you to train really large models. If you see, by each passing day, the models are becoming larger and larger. So it is very easy to have models with like 60 million parameters, 70 million parameters. The highest is, I think, the what I have heard is 6 billion. Of course, not individual researchers can train models of that size. But that is the general direction where we are headed. And if we can't conserve memory aggressively, we can't reach that level. This point is clear with everyone? Okay. So I'm going to show you some stats. Okay. So these are the memory requirements after MXNet was deployed. So for AlexNet, so for AlexNet model, it requires 1.8 times less memory. For Inception model, it requires 2.6 times less memory. For VGG, it requires half the memory. So while this number half may not look so impressive, you know, it literally save you half the cost, right? Because your trainings run for days and weeks. GPU machines are extremely expensive, even when they when you use them in cloud. And it literally saves you almost half the cost of your training. Okay, even for predictions, right, for the same level of performance, you require 3 to 4 times less amount of memory. Baseline is without these optimizations. Regardless, whichever framework you use, right, the number of parameters which are there, they dictate how much memory you require. You understand, right? It is not dependent on TensorFlow or Torch or whatever. How many layers you have, how many parameters you have, what is the precision of the outputs, right? That is what dictates memory. That is what dictates the baseline. So at Amazon, we love I'll talk to you at the end, okay? So yeah, as I said, parallel and distributed training in MXNet is extremely easy. So there is something called as drop-in parallelization. So all you need to do to train parallelly it just add one line of code once the network is set up. So if you are doing training on AWS, we provide you CloudFormation template, which sets the cluster up. And if you want to go from one machine to multiple machines, all you do is you just add one line of code. So if you can't use memory efficiently, your training doesn't scale linearly with compute. What I mean is, if the memory utilization is not efficient, if you add four times more machine, it doesn't mean that your performance improves by four times. Okay? But since MXNet handles memory so efficiently, its performance improves linearly with the added number of machines. Okay? So in this graph, what it shows is the compute time has come down by a factor of 3.7, right? When four machines were added in place of one machine. Okay? So this is a neat feature. Like in Hadoop, the processing time improves linearly with the number of machines you add to the cluster. So far, it was not happening in the GPU world because a lot of memory and data transfers were involved. But since MXNet handles memory so efficiently, the performance scales near linearly with the number of machines you add. So again, parallel training happens under the hood. Conceptually, it is no different from how it happens in any other framework. But implementation-wise, it is very easy. You just launch a cluster using a CloudFormation template. And if you want to have multiple machines, just add one line in your program. That's all. All the parallelization is taken care of automatically. Okay. So this is a graph on the linearity. So gray line indicates the ideal performance. Blue line indicates MXNet's performance, which is almost following the ideal performance. Whereas these yellow line indicates performance of the frameworks which don't optimize memory aggressively. So you can see that, you know, if you add large number of machines, if your framework doesn't optimize memory efficiently, there is no benefit that you are deriving. This is another cool feature of MXNet. It has got plugins. So what it means is, if you're a Torch developer and if you have developed Torch modules, you can use them from MXNet. If you have cafe operations, you can directly use them from MXNet. So I'm done discussing the memory optimization and efficiency part. Now I'm going to discuss some cool features. And as I said, if you are coming from Torch world, if you are coming from Cafe world, and you have done a lot of investment in those frameworks, you can reuse their modules and operations respectively in MXNet. Yeah, there are tons of mainstream applications which have been developed in vision, NLP, and speech area. So as I said, MXNet is a framework of choice at Amazon, and there are many other large companies which are using MXNet. So there is a lot of ready-made code available for you to get started. The code is very easy to read. That is what I love about MXNet. And MXNet also has Keras support now. If you prefer to use Keras, you'll feel at home. So that said, I have a bunch of other slides, and I have just 1 minute left. So let me see. Okay, cool. So yeah, MXNet, you can do programming using Python, Scala, R, Julia, MATLAB, JavaScript, Go, right? So you don't have to change your programming language. This is a cool feature of MXNet. It is open source. You know, whether you want to run it in Amazon, you want to run it on Azure, you want to run it at home, doesn't matter. Next is, it is extremely portable. You can deploy it anywhere. So you can compile MXNet program into a single file. So you don't have a framework and a model, no two different files, a single lightweight file, which can be run on a mobile phone or any embedded device. Models can be so lightweight that they run inside browsers. So that said, I just want to guide you to this further leading list. I will share the PPT, so you can take a look at it. So yeah, if you are going to train large models, if cost is a concern, do consider MXNet. It is extremely easy to use. No brainer, very easy to write and easy to read code. That said, I finish exactly on time.